to Raconteurs News.
And good evening, and welcome to Raconteurs News, as Susie so succinctly puts it there on the intro. It is Thursday night, it's referendum day, and we are all Brexited here at on Raconteurs News. We hope you've been out and voted. If you haven't been out and voted, then please get yourself out to vote with your heart, really, but as long as it's exit. I went in to vote earlier on, and one of the girls, a young lady in front of me, said to the people, "Do I pop this in here?" Talking about her vote, and does she put it into the ballot box? And I said, "Yes, you put it in there, unless it's a vote remain, in which case it goes in this bin here." hopefully, if all things being equal, I think we're on our way out. But as we know, things aren't really equal. Well, I'm Jason Holmes. This is Raconteurs News. We're broadcasting live on this Thursday night from raconteursnews.com and also on Spreaker as well. And as usual, Andy Young is here with me as well. How you doing, Andy?
I'm doing great, Jason, which is better than I can say for the weather. Did you see, strangely enough, I'm sure it's just a coincidence, but there's reports on the South Coast this morning that they had 1 month's rain in 1 hour. So a lot of roads are flooded and also part of the tube network. So a lot of people ain't going to be able to get home in time to vote.
Yeah, but apparently there have been a lot of companies that have been sending their employees home early due to the inclement weather down in the southeast. That's what I've heard. This is all the nonsense on the news.
A bit like when you was at school and it snowed, and you had to go on the bus, so they sent you home early. Is it like that?
I think it's something like that. Yeah, I think either the water pipes are frozen up or whatever. But it's certainly been an interesting day. There's been a lot of things going on, and it looks like we've got another lone shooter at a public place somewhere in Germany. But we'll have to wait until everything develops from that and see whether that's of any significance. But tonight we are joined by author John Hamer, who's here to tell us about his new book. His new book is out at the moment. It came out, I think, about May time. How are you doing, John? How are you?
I'm good, Jason. Thanks. How are you both?
We're good, yeah, mate. Thanks, John.
Yeah, that's we're great. Pretty good. We're sleeping with our head 10 inches above, 6 inches above our feet. So we're all very, very, very well here tonight. So let's kick off. Give us your take on the referendum, just for a quick start, just to get it out of the way. Then we can concentrate on your book.
Right. Okay. No punches pulled. I don't have to be politically correct or anything.
Nope. You can do it.
Right.
You can say
I concur with what you said. Absolutely. You know, let's get out. Unfortunately, I think the thing will be rigged. I don't think that we'll come out, even if the vote is, is for actually leaving. I've been using this quote quite a few times in the last few days, but it's a quote from a certain Mr. Joseph Stalin, who one or two people may have heard of. And he said famously, "It's not the votes that count, it's who counts the votes." And that just sums it up for me, because they ain't going to let us leave. Whatever happens, they are not going to let us leave, because it's just too big a part of the agenda, basically.
Yeah, yeah. Words of wisdom from the original Smoking Joe there, yeah.
Yeah, I don't agree with that many things that he said, but that's probably one of them. Yeah.
So you're not anticipating tomorrow morning we're all going to wake up and everybody's going to the all over the news it's going to say we are out of Europe.
No.
No.
In a word, no. I just cannot see it. I mean, if that is the case. And it's highly unlikely, but I reckon if that is the case, the same thing will happen as happened in Ireland over in a similar set of circumstances. They'll just have the vote again until they get the result that they want. But I don't think they'll need to do that, because when you're rigging it, you don't need to do that, do you? So there you go.
Yeah, there's been a history of that. I know that it happened in Ireland, didn't it, with the Lisbon Treaty. They said to them, sorry, you got that one wrong.
Yeah,
when you answered the first time, and then they did it until really they got the answer that they wanted.
Yeah, and apparently all the early exit polls are saying it's going to be Leave, but of course, there's exactly the same thing happened over the Scotland leaving the UK, didn't it? And all the exit polls. And to be fair, they've got these exit polls off to a very fine art, so they're highly scientific, and they know they should be very accurate. So it's a bit of a surprise, actually, in one sense that that never happened, because the exit polls for Scotland coming out were something like 55% in favour of coming out, and yet I think the final result was just the opposite. I think it was 55% in favour. Total fix.
Yeah, I'm not sure about all these polls, John. The ones that I know are usually under somebody's kitchen cupboard fixing their sink.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
Xenophobic outer there, you xenophobic fool. That's what you'd be accused of by the BBC, particularly for saying something like that.
It's
racism. I mean, let's use the word that they would use. They would say racist. They wouldn't use anything posh like xenophobe, because racism is sort of being inured into our society now, hasn't it? Because, it's to stave off criticism on immigration, basically. That's what the word racism is all about.
And also to prevent anyone ever criticising Israel, because a lot of countries will go to prison for that now.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
questioning. And rightly so, you should go to prison for things that come out of your mouth, thought crimes, as it were. Anyway, I think we should move on just a little bit.
Little diversion there, wasn't it? But
never mind. Yeah, well, we got you on because you're a bit of a raconteur when it comes to skullduggery and things that are not quite right. And you've written a couple of books. One's the RMS Olympic, which is all about the Titanic incident and, of course, how it was switched in your book. And also, of course, the falsification of history. Now, I understand you've just had you've just published another book. Do you want to tell us about that?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, it's a very big book. It's 1,100 pages, and it's about 10 inches by 7 inches. It's about 3 inches thick or more. So it's a big book, and it's hard to summarise in a few sentences, but I'll do my best. I mean, the angle that I'm coming from, really, is it's similar in a lot of ways to falsification of history. I cover some of the same topics, but I also go a lot further than that now, because as time's gone on, I think what I've, from a personal point of view, I've actually come to a not a different conclusion, but I've sort of refined my conclusions now to say exactly how and why it's been done and by whom. Okay, in falsification of history, it was just this nebulous them that were doing it, whereas now I think I've got a proper handle on exactly who's doing it. I think we've always known why, but I think I've sort of tried to narrow it down a little bit as to who it is. And I reckon the premise of the book is that it's the big bankers that are behind it all. I mean, that people tell you it's the Jews, it's the Jesuits, it's the Illuminati, it's this secret controllers of the world or whatever. It's just a label, really. But like I said, the premise of the book is that I pin the blame on the people who run the banks. But I suppose in a sense that's not surprising, because the people who run the banks run everything else as well. Because if you follow all the pyramids in society right to the top, it's the same people at the apex, of every single, pyramidal structure that you can think of within society, whether that be companies, secret societies, you name it. It's absolutely the same people, the same families at the very top.
Do you think in recent years it's become not so secret? It's the cat is sort of getting out of the bag?
A little bit, but I mean, you still get, if you dare to sort of broach the subject, you still get labelled with the epithet conspiracy theorist. And speaking about definitions, I had a good definition of a conspiracy theorist given to me the other day as well, which I'd like to share, and that was somebody who doesn't watch as much television as you do. That's a conspiracy theorist. Which takes a little bit of thinking about, but you get there in the end. It's a bit, yeah. So, yeah. But what I was, sorry, what I was going to carry on to say was that, stop me if I ramble on, because I know I do tend to ramble sometimes, but I've sort of pinned it on the bankers, because what I believe is that it was actually the taking over of the ability to create money from nothing, which is what these people did many centuries ago, and have slowly, over time, got to the point where that allowed them to generate so much money that they could buy everything else. So that's why I've pinned it on the bankers, if you like. But these bankers, you could call them anything. But I believe that the whole thing started and was facilitated by the corruption in the monetary system.
Mm. Yeah, it certainly seems that way to me, John. And we couldn't have planned it better. We've got a guy that we speak to more or less on a monthly basis called Paul, our high-level financial insider. I've been speaking to Paul for close on 3 years now. And for some reason, he couldn't make his June update, or was it the May update? We had to cancel at the last minute because he had family problems. And we had to slot him in somewhere, and we booked up till the middle of next month. So I said, oh, what about doing Wednesday? And he said, yeah, no problem, do that. And didn't realise till halfway through the show last night, we've got him talking about the impending collapse of the financial industry, and then you on the following night. So it couldn't have worked out better, really.
Yeah, it is. Sorry, we've not mentioned your new book up till yet. It's called Behind the Curtain, A Chilling Exposé of the Banking Industry. It's volume one, so there's going to be more to come as well. So what sort of subjects do you cover in this book?
Within the banking thing?
Yeah, behind the curtain, yeah.
Behind the curtain, yeah. It's, it's virtually everything. I mean, it's just the whole, I suppose you could call it the Grant conspiracy. Just basically using the bankers as the scapegoats, if you like, just explaining how everything that is going on in the world relates back.
Well, I think we lost you a bit there. How was that your end, Andy? Are you still there, John?
Yeah, it was just cutting out momentarily.
So first of all, it goes about the usurpation of the control of money. And then it moves to, could you just talk amongst yourself for 2 seconds? Because I've got a little problem this end, actually. Sorry.
Yeah,
I'm not at home, so I need to grab some more data. I beg your pardon about this.
Not a problem, John. Not a problem.
Yeah, just give me 2 minutes. Sorry, guys. I do apologise.
Yeah.
Okay. We could talk amongst ourselves, can't we?
Yeah, I was looking through the preview bit on Amazon earlier on. And I did see in the, what's it called, the foreword, talking about Jerome Daly, a lawyer by profession, who defended himself against the bank's attempted foreclosure on his $14,000 mortgage on the grounds that there was no consideration for the loan. Consideration in legalese refers to the item exchanged and is an essential part of any legal contract.
A contract can't exist without consideration.
That's right, yeah, there's 7 elements of contract law. Daly contended that the bank offered no consideration for this loan on the grounds that they had created the money out of thin air by a bookkeeping entry and had therefore not suffered a loss, another relevant point of the law, by his refusal or inability to pay back the money. And he actually won that case. So there is some precedent that, you know, basically mortgages are and loans are a bunch of hokum.
Yeah, and they'll come up with some sort of where they'll say this loophole has been closed.
Mm.
Because anytime anybody challenges and wins, that then becomes what they call a loophole, and this loophole needs to be closed. So, while it's a precedent, and it is great news, we still need to be cautious and keep paying our mortgage.
Well, you know, absolutely, yeah. I wouldn't
there's still people. There's still people trying to use it, but it the problem with it is that the courts have been corrupted by it as well, by them as well now, and the courts are just putting every obstacle you can possibly think of in the way of it actually, of that defence actually succeeding, to the point where they've actually bent the law to make that the case, which I suppose is no surprise really, but there you go.
Yeah, that's what they've done. Banking is just legalised theft, really, isn't it? I mean, I'm sure you agree with the research that you've done.
Yeah.
So, when you was uncovering all this this banking stuff, how far did you find the rabbit hole went?
Very deep indeed. I mean, you know, even just the creation of money, you know, if you start there, I mean, that is completely illegal. You know, the way that they do it, I mean, I'll outline that for the benefit of the listeners if there are people out there who don't fully understand exactly how our money is created. Well, first of all, it's not created by governments. The power to create and generate money and currency and print currency is not within the hands of governments. There are only three countries in the world that don't have a central bank whose function it is to create money, and that is Iran, Syria. Sorry, Iran, North Korea, and Cuba. The latest two dominoes to fall were Libya and Syria, and I think that speaks volumes anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's significant that the three that are left are the ones that have put up as being public enemies number one in the world. Okay, they're the three countries that the Western world, for want of a better expression, is trying to subdue in whatever way it can, because basically they want to get a central bank in there. Now, what central banks do is they create money absolutely out of thin air, and they do that in the form of loans and mortgages. That's how money is actually generated. So if, say, the government needs another £1 billion injected into the economy, it will go to the Bank of England, which, by the way, is a privately owned corporation whose shareholders are non-disclosed, and ask them, go cap in hand and say, could we have £1 billion, please? Yes, you can, but we need £1 billion worth of government bonds in exchange for that, which are, you know, real. They do have a value of £1 billion. So then they create this money, paper money, which is not backed by anything at all, no gold, no silver, no nothing. It's just basically monopoly money. You know, the only reason that it's legal tender is because we believe it's legal tender and we're told it's legal tender. But it's just worthless pieces of paper. I think I read somewhere it costs them about £180 to print £1 billion worth of currency. So that's what it costs the central banks, £180. And then the government owes them that £1 billion in government bonds. Then they have to pay interest on that billion as well.
Mm-hmm.
But it's even worse than that, because when you go to a bank for a loan, you know, your local bank of NatWest or whatever, and say you want to borrow, I don't know, 10 grand to buy a car or 100 grand on a mortgage or whatever, they don't have a pile of notes in a vault somewhere that they move somewhere into your account. It's just numbers on a computer screen. And before computers, it was just ledger entries. But the brilliant thing for banks is that the way that they use the bookkeeping is totally fraudulent, and it's totally against accountancy practice, because what they do is, say they've got a pot of 10 million to lend, and you borrow, no, I'll make it simpler, so they've got a pot of 1 million to lend, and you want to borrow £100,000 for a house. What they actually should do is deduct that £100,000 from in double entry bookkeeping from the put it onto the debit side of the ledger. But what they actually do is put it onto the credit side of the ledger. So they then have 1.1 million instead of 900,000, if that makes sense. But it's completely fraudulent what they do, and obviously somebody knows that this is going on. I mean, auditors must check these things. You know, it must be happening millions of times a day around the banking system of the world, but yet it still goes on. You know, where's the auditing? Or if there is auditing, it's completely fraudulent. But the best thing then, of course, for the men is not only did they lend you 100 grand that they've added to the credit side of their bookkeeping system, but then you've got to pay interest on that 100 grand. And if you don't keep up with those interest payments on that 100 grand, the 100 grand that never existed in the first place, they'll come and take your property away, which has got a tangible value. And this is how they've gained control of the world through this practice over the centuries. And one by one, the dominoes have fallen in each country around the world, and a central bank has been established. And well, as I said, there's only three countries in the entire world now that don't have a Rothschild-controlled central bank.
So does Syria have a Rothschild bank? Because I was under on the understanding that they didn't, and which is why they were still trying to...
I'm actually doubting myself now, mate. I might be getting mixed up with Libya, actually, because that's what the incursion into Libya was, wasn't it? Before they actually invaded Libya and all that hoo-ha there, they actually, Libyan rebels, would you believe, before the West went in, set up a central bank, because what's his name, Gaddafi, had already decided to start his own currency, bypassing the world, the IMF and the World Bank.
Yeah, weren't it going to be a gold-backed dinar?
That's right.
For the Middle East. In fact, I think it was an Ash. He gave a speech, didn't he, at an African leaders' convention, where he said that where he brought this up, this idea up.
Yeah.
Of the gold-backed dinar, and I suppose that's what. Signed his death warrant, really.
That was the
same as Kennedy and Lincoln.
Absolutely, that was the straw that broke the camel's back. And what a lot of people don't know is that Libya, up until the death of Gaddafi, was one of the most prosperous nations in the world. They had free healthcare, free dentists. You know, it's a very affluent country. But as soon as the central banks came in, of course, they suck all the wealth of the nation into their own accounts.
Wait, do you think that in Libya, before all this, Gaddafi became bad again, he'd become good because Tony Blair was over there, and of course we had the situation with Abdel Bassett Ali Mohammed Al Megrahi, who was the alleged Libyan bomber as well, and he'd gone back as. Do you think that they tried to charm Libya first, and then once they realised that wasn't happening, they decided to use the hammer?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's the modus operandi. You know, they send a guy called an economic hitman. If anybody's ever read the book Confessions of an Economic Hitman by John Perkins, the American guy, it's absolutely fascinating. And that relates in great detail how they do it. They send somebody in like him, and they offer the president or the... get, you know, their contact over there, the high-level contact over there, all sorts of riches and blah, 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 basically to sell the country's soul to them. If they don't fall for that, then they start putting the pressure on. If they don't, like sanctions, economic sanctions, all that stuff. And then if they still don't play ball, they're dead. And that happens time after time after time. It happened at all the South American countries in the 80s and the 90s, well, the 70s, 80s and 90s. And Perkins was involved in a lot of that, and his book is quite revealing, actually. So it's a recommended read because that exactly explains how they do it.
Yeah, I've not read Confessions of an Economic Hitman, but I have heard of it, and I've heard it being spoken about, and it's pretty sinister, isn't it? I mean, it goes into details about how they would go into a country. By whatever means, they will get some sort of angle on whoever's leading that country.
Yeah.
And then lend them billions and billions of dollars that they could never pay back, and then mop up their natural resources.
Yeah. Well, what they did in, I think it was it Nicaragua? Might have been Nicaragua or Colombia. I can't remember one of those places around that area. They took control of the water system and quadrupled the price of water. And the people fought back, actually. It was never really sort of publicised, but the people fought back, and eventually the people won. But it was a hell of a struggle, and there was a lot of people killed over it. But that's a typical sort of tactic. You know, okay, you can't pay the loans back. Well, we'll take over your water infrastructure then. We'll take over your power generation infrastructure, or both, or all of it. And that's how they do it. They suck up the wealth of a country and, you know, gain complete control in that way. And I think that's, you know, that sort of emphasizes the point that I made at the beginning, that it's the bankers, although you could attribute it to any number of different people, because, you know, not only the bankers, but they own most of the corporations as well. But as I keep saying, it's the facilitation of that, the money, which gives them the power to do it. And that's why I sort of attribute it to the bankers.
But we fall for it, don't we? Because we're quite childish when it comes to this sort of thing, and we don't really do as research. I mean, people will read on the news that Colonel Gaddafi's were a right bastard, or you know, yeah, he murdered his people, and we have any evidence, and they'll actually believe that.
No, absolutely.
And so it is a really sinister situation. But do you think that they try to wine and dine them? I think you've already answered this sort of question, but especially with Gaddafi, they tried to wine and dine him. He then spoken at an international African leaders conference, and then the next thing he's got a knife up his arse. You know, he's been killed by his own, supposedly his own people as well. This is another thing. Whereas from what I've seen, I don't think that anybody in Libya, any right-minded Libyan, would have had a problem with Colonel Gaddafi.
Yeah, all right, I'm sure he wasn't an angel. I mean, who is? And, you know, everybody's going to have a little bit of a finger in the tail, aren't they, who's in a position to do that. Like I say, I'm sure he wasn't an angel, but I think he was basically an honourable guy, because he wouldn't give in to them. He wouldn't allow them to come in, and, you know, he put his people first, basically. Well, probably put himself first, to be fair, but he certainly put his people second, not bottom.
Yeah, I mean, for Gaddafi, you've only got to take a look at the footage of him when he was doing public appearances. You'd see him driving down the street in a car with his head stuck out the sunroof, touching hands with the whole crowd.
That's right.
Whereas you don't see any Western leaders doing that. They're usually in a bulletproof limousine surrounded by hundreds of armed bodyguards. Whereas Gaddafi, I mean, also look at Gaddafi's housing policy. When he came to power, he swore that he wouldn't house his own parents until every last person in Libya had a home. And apparently he stuck to that.
Yeah, absolutely. So,
His dad died before he was housed. That's just how far. I mean, again, this is things that I'm reading from different places, and I haven't got the validation of them all. But it, to me, it just seems that there's two sides to every story, and we only really ever get the bankers' side.
That's absolutely right. Yeah, I mean, it was the same to a lesser extent with Saddam Hussein as well. Mm-hmm. I mean, okay, again, not an angel by any stretch of the imagination. He feathered his own nest, of course, but the people loved him compared to what they'd had to put up with under the previous regimes. I mean, he was a well-respected man, and as you said before, Andy, he could drive around in an open top limo as well, and you know, nobody was after him, nobody wanted to get rid of him. All that business about when the Americans went in and you saw the picture of them toppling that statue—it was all faked. Mm. It was all staged for the cameras, because I've seen actual photographs of that from a different angle. There's only about 35 people there in the crowd, but they made it look like it was an entire mob, rampaging mob, rejoicing over his death. But there were just a few people, a few dissidents, and most of them had been cajoled and paid by the CIA anyway to be there.
Well, you look at Saddam, and he was armed and supported by the West for most of his tenure, wasn't he? I mean, he came to power in about 58 or 59 when, I believe it was King Isidris went on holiday, and Gaddafi saw his opportunity, jumped in there, I only know about that because I had an old German friend when I lived out in Spain, and he was actually working in the oil industry in Libya at the time it happened. And they actually threw everyone out of the country apart from the American American employees of the oil companies. Right. So that's quite telling of what was happening there, wasn't it?
Absolutely. And you know, they keep these people as long as they're useful to them. And then as soon as something happens and it's expedient to bump them off, they'll just do that. You know, no qualms, no. And but they do a massive PR media job on him first, you know, to make him out to be the devil, basically, for a little while before it's sunk into the, you know, all our psyches, you know, that, ooh, Saddam equals bad.
Mm.
America and Britain and Israel equals good. And, you know, once that's sort of, you know, been put into our heads for long enough and hard enough, then they'll do it and they can get away with it because people just say, well, he got what was coming to him.
Mm. Well,
yeah, it's perception management, isn't it?
You look at not so long back, there were there was quite a lot of footage of Tony Blair and Gaddafi embracing, and they were best buddies. Mm. But then suddenly he wants to create a golden dinar, and boom, he's the bad guy.
Absolutely, yeah.
But like you said, with the toppling of the statue of Saddam that happened, we've all seen pictures of that, and it appears from the angle that we're shown that there's thousands of people there, and it's something that's spontaneous.
Yeah.
But once you take a step back, and you see that there's just a very small group.
Yeah.
But again, it's perception management. But we're so susceptible to that in the West that we will just see something and simply believe it.
Yeah. Well, that's 60-odd years of TV for you, because TV has spent the last 65 years conditioning us to accept what we see on a screen. If we see it on a screen, it's true. There's so many examples of green screening now in the news. You know, they just make situations up and they show situations from different circumstances and pretend that it's a completely new set of circumstances. By that I mean that it might be a riot in Baghdad and they dress it up as a riot in Syria. If it's expedient to do that and they want to demonize something in Syria, they don't care what footage they use to make the point. They just use it. And as I say, you know, TV has, unfortunately, over the years that when it's been sort of freely available, it's conditioned us to believe what they want us to believe. I mean, there's a whole section in the book about that as well.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And an example of what's happened in the last week or 10 days, following the event that happened with the MP Joe Cox and the hoo-ha that's going on there, there seems to be... there's a fund being set up in her memory, and one of the major beneficiaries of that fund is the White Helmets. Now, we're all told in the press, particularly the BBC, that these White Helmets are marvellous knights in shining armour that are going in to help the people of Syria, whereas the reality is far from that. You know, we've had Eva Bartlett on this show, and she's been out there to Syria and to Gaza, and she said these White Helmets, they are simply aiding the terrorists, and they're an NGO funded, as far as I'm aware, by the British government, and they're really not doing what we're told they're doing. So, you know, surely that is something that should alert people that there's something not altogether savoury about what's going on there.
Well, absolutely. But people, you know, even if you actually grabbed somebody by the throat and sat them down in front of a, you know, something that proved that was what was happening, they still wouldn't believe it because they're so inured in this culture that we have, this, you know, that, you know, our government tells us the truth, television tells us the truth. We're so far down that road that it's so difficult to actually change people's minds or to get people to you know, to think outside the box.
Exactly.
Well, I've been in Manchester this afternoon, and everywhere I went, I've been accosted by people saying, "Are you going to vote Remain? Are you going to vote Remain?" Nobody for Brexit at all campaigning on the streets.
Mm.
You know, but the point I was making is that I couldn't be bothered, to be honest. I was going at one point to stop and just chat to them and say, you know, what on earth? How on earth can you even begin to justify staying in the EU? You know, what sort of a brain does anybody have who feels that it's beneficial to the British people to stay in that? It just beggars belief to me. But then when you think about it more deeply, you realise that it's because people are just brainwashed. They latch upon somebody's opinion, or they hear it over and over and over again on the TV, and then it suddenly becomes their opinion. And they can't see past that then. It's a strange phenomenon, but no doubt some psychologists will be able to explain it. But I thought, well, I'd just be wasting my time if I did that. But
well, exactly. Yeah. We get on the mainstream news, we get so many things that when you stand back and take a real look at them, they're completely ridiculous. Mm. I suppose a good example would be aluminium aeroplanes vanishing inside concrete and steel buildings, but you just can't tell some people that that's not physically possible.
No.
And the fact that they can't fly at 550 mile an hour at that altitude, you know, rip the wings off, blah-de-blah-de-blah. Yeah. No trained military or airline pilot could ever fly the manoeuvres of the planes that supposedly flow into those towers. But people just believe it because it's in the TV. And then you've got celebrities like Bob, as in Poop Geldof, telling people that, you know, this is the way you should vote and screw you, fishermen. And then you've got the likes of Bonio, who I thought was quite a cool dude till he disappeared up his own backside. And it appears he's committing massive fraud with his foundation. And, you know,
absolutely.
I'm sure he'd be interested in suing us, but then he'd have to prove that he's telling the truth. So not got no worries there. They've just got an interesting snippet posted in the chat room by Jeff. Thanks, Jeff. And he says that according to Richie Allen, would you believe the presiding judge in the case of the murder of Joe Cox is the same one who oversaw the Lee Rigby trial and the judge that ordered Lord Greville Channer was unfit to face trial on charges of sexually abusing children?
Well, that's very interesting, actually. Yeah, thanks for that, whoever wrote that. But, yeah, it doesn't surprise me in the slightest, obviously. I mean, but,
I'd like a little bit of clarification of which Lee Rigby trial. Are we talking about the murder trial, or are we talking about Chris Spivey's? He had a trial, didn't he, for harassment? I don't know. So I'd like to know which trial it was. But yeah, that it is really telling and revealing.
Yeah. I suspect he means the trial of the two alleged assailants rather than Chris Spivey. I'm guessing. I don't think. It would be Chris. I might be wrong, but my first instinct would be to say the.
That was Chris, anyway. I know you're writing some articles for his website, don't you?
Yeah, he's not been too good, I don't think, but it's all right. He's bearing up. He's got really bad arthritis at the moment. Hope you don't mind me telling you that, but he's okay. And I think under the circumstances, what he's having to put up with, you know, the harassment and everything, and. I think he's a little bit down in the dumps from time to time, but he's a good man. He keeps on, you know, keeps on keeping on.
Mm. Yeah, he is a good man. We had him on not long after on this show on Raconteurs News, not long after we'd had you on, actually. Right. So right. I think we'll probably give him a call up and see if he wants to get himself back on and tell us about what's been going on in his life.
But yeah, sure.
I was interested in what you were talking about earlier on. When you said that you were in Manchester today and you've got three or four people approaching you, asking you if you're going to vote Remain.
Yeah, it was more than that, actually. I bet it was about eight.
Right, so you've got eight people voting. Now, this, psychologically, to me, that seems like it's it's repetition, which is a neuro-linguistic programming technique. So if you, because I would have thought that, in fact, I think I do believe it, that you're not allowed to campaign on the actual election day. Is that right?
I don't know that. I've not heard that, to be honest, Jason. Interesting if so.
I was listening to the BBC 5 Live this morning, and they said that there is no campaigning on the actual day of the vote, which is the reason why they didn't have anybody on who was either pro or anti-Remain.
Well, they should have told the people or the groups of people that were around thrusting leaflets in people's face telling them to vote Remain.
Yeah, I think that's pretty much been the Remain camp's tactics, hasn't it? It's all been underhand. What did you make of the murder of the Labour MP and Remain campaigner, Joe Cox?
Obviously, there's no definitive answer to that, but my own, as soon as it happened, I thought, hello, very, very strange, very, very, very fishy. And it was only like about the following day when it occurred to me. I'm sure this sounds familiar. And it was like about 13 years ago, was it, in Sweden, a lady by the name of Anna Lind, who was a Swedish MP who was voting for, was it to stay or to put Sweden into the Euro?
To adopt the Euro, yes. She was campaigning to adopt the Euro, which, and then she was murdered a week before the election.
Yeah, in very similar circumstances. And she was a woman of a similar age, young woman. I think they do that to generate most sympathy for the cause. It's not, if it had been an old guy, you know, like a sort of a 70-year-old decrepit old MP, it wouldn't have had the same effect, would it? But a young woman with a young family, you know, I mean, it also begs the question, is she even dead? In the reaction of the family afterwards would say to me, no, I don't think she is, actually, because what was the first thing that her husband said on the same day that she was killed? This is a new beginning for us. What the hell does that mean? You know, if that had been my wife that had been brutally murdered in the street, I wouldn't have wanted to talk to anybody. I'd have said, just leave me alone. I want to grieve in peace. But it comes out with this fantastic, what appeared to me like a scripted statement about it all being a new beginning. And there didn't seem to be any grief in there at all. It was just bizarre. So I just found it all very suspicious, I suppose, is the answer to your question. But I can't really, you know, definitively come up with an answer.
No, John, I haven't seen the whatever it was that her husband said, but I have seen the footage of a sister reading out a statement with the family behind her. And for someone whose immediate family member had just been murdered, there was an awful lot of smiles going on between them. And just a little side note on the murder of Anna Lind. She was actually murdered on September the 11th, 2003.
Right, was she? I didn't know that, yeah.
It's a date that does seem to be very popular with these scumbags, doesn't it?
Absolutely, yeah. They love the numerology, don't they? But that's another story altogether.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I mean...
It's Curtis's birthdays.
What, sorry?
I said it's probably it's probably one of their birthdays, and that it's as simple as that, that's the reason why the date is used.
Well, who knows?
It definitely is used very often.
Yeah. Mm.
Well, it has been suggested by a lot of people, and I've seen people claiming that it's absolute cast iron fact that it was actually Jesus's birthday. I mean, we're told that he was born on December the 25th, when it appears that he was actually born in the summertime. But December the 25th is an old pagan holiday, as is Easter, Ishtar.
Yeah, well, it's also to do with the solstice, isn't it? And and that's why they say that Jesus died and then was resurrected on the third day. Well, the 25th of December is the third day after the winter solstice. Put my teeth in. Yeah, so it's all connected with that as well. So
yeah, well, that story of died on a cross, born of a virgin, died on a cross, rose again, after 3 days. That is in so many ancient religions. They all just seem to be rehashing the same old story. And what I can gather, it's based on astrotheology. Mm. You know, it's what happens in the sky. It's nothing to do with any real people that may or may not have done any certain things on those days.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
And, of course, if Jesus was born on September the 11th, he was a Virgo, and he was born of a virgin. So that makes sense as well, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah, yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, not thought about that, but yeah, yeah. Good one.
Yeah, good find there, Jason.
yeah, so we've got this MP who's involved in the Remain campaign, and like you said, we've got a lot of similarities between her and Anna Lind. And what's particularly interesting is they've always got young children, haven't they? They've always got young children.
Just to maximise the sympathy, isn't it? You know. Oh, the poor woman, you know. Oh, poor thing, those poor children. How could anybody do such a thing? Terrible. Awful. Mm. I won't vote to stay in now. Oh, no, sod that.
Yeah, well, it's like so many of these stories that don't quite appear to be what we're first told. And as you start seeing the reporting unfolding, I mean, it's quite a common thing now that we obviously don't need police anymore, because the BBC are able to solve any crime and know all about it within milliseconds of it actually taking place.
Absolutely,
so, you know,
they give you chapter and verse 5 minutes after it's happened, don't they?
Yeah.
They believe that so-and-so is responsible. Yeah.
Exactly. And I wonder, you know, are they going to slip up again and make another mistake like the destruction of Building 7, which was actually reported about 27 minutes before it actually took place?
Yeah. Somebody read the script too early, didn't they? That was the problem.
Yes, that was Jane Standley. And
it was.
Removed from the BBC's website, and they actually said that it never actually happened. But there's enough people out there who've got video captures of it, and it's all over YouTube, and I think the cat's well and truly out of the bag on that one.
Definitely. Yeah. Yeah,
well, I think we should perhaps change the roles of different organisations. The BBC could become the new police, and the police could then perhaps, you know, show us EastEnders and some drama on TV, because it took the BBC 10-15 minutes to solve every major crime, false flag shooting and all that sort of thing. But it took the police 2 years to find out that Cliff Richard had not been bumming children.
I like it. Yeah, very good.
You see, so if we switch it around, the BBC, is obviously, they solve crimes.
Yeah. Do you think anybody would actually notice, though, Jess?
Sorry?
Do you think anybody would actually notice if we did swap them around? They probably wouldn't.
Well, it appears that...
You're watching EastEnders, aren't they?
Yeah, it appears that rather than journalism nowadays, these people are just copy and pasters of police press statements.
yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
And if you look at the Orlando shooter, that is Kyle Walker, England, the right back for England at the moment. Just have a look at the image of Omar Mateen's name, isn't it? The alleged Orlando shooter. If you look at an image of him, he looks exactly the same as Kyle Walker, right back for England at the moment.
We've just plucked a photograph off the internet. Oh, he'll do. We'll have him and it's starting to be Kyle Walker.
Well, nobody in America is going to know who Kyle Walker is, are they? I mean, they're going to think, well, who's going to know this guy?
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting there you raised about Kitty not having enough evidence to secure a conviction. But that news actually broke the day of the Joe Cox incident. So that just reminded me when I realised that the two things had happened on the same day, and Cliff not being a bum bandit didn't get any reporting. I thought, I remember a memo that went out on September the 11th, 2001, that said, this is a good day to bury bad news.
Absolutely, yeah.
again, perception management. That's what it's all about. Everything's all about perception management, and perception is everything. If you look at people, how people react and respond to other people online, you can see that that's because their perception of that other group of people has been skewed, and it's been manipulated.
Yeah.
Mm.
And which is why we're in such deep doo-doo, I think, anyway.
Well, and also with this issue of perception management, I mean, that kind of relates to John's book, really, because there's enough people out there telling the world and anyone who listen that the whole banking system is a fraud, it's a means of enslavement, it's been going on for thousands of years. Yet, if you watch enough BBC, the banks are so marvellous, we couldn't possibly survive without them. Mm-hmm. And anyone who challenges them is a freeman on the land. I mean, we've got friends who come on the show occasionally, such like as Kevin Mark and Paul Webster, who were challenging the utility companies in court because all commerce is done internationally and nationally on the bills of exchange. Now, when you're sent a utility bill, if you get sent a bill rather than pay by direct debit, what they actually do is they send you a check with your name on it and an amount in figures. But then they trick you into going into the bank or the post office and paying it again. Mm. Now, what these guys are doing is saying, well, no, under the bills of exchange, this is a check, it's in my name. I tried doing that years ago without half a clue about the bills of exchange, but I thought, hang on, it used to say bank gyro check on the bottom, which they call a paying in slip. And I went into the bank, I went into the post office and tried to cash it in both places and they wouldn't have it. And I thought, oh, well, maybe I'm just barking up the wrong tree. But it appears kind of 20 or 30 years before I found out the truth about the matter, I kind of sussed it. Mm. But you try and tell people about the fact that these bills are already paid and under a non-commercial agreement, you're not liable. It's only corporations that are liable to pay for these things. But they come back at you with things as ridiculous as, well, my gas bill goes up because you don't pay yours. And you can demonstrate them factually in law, the bill is already paid.
Yeah. But I know, the problem with that is even if you went to court over it, you still lose because the court is biased in favour of the corporations. I'm sure some of the very senior judges know what the truth is, but I don't know. I tend to think that some of the lesser lights in the legal system are just as clueless as us about it.
Yeah, well, I know several people who've been to court, and rather than let them have the victory, which would make case law and it would bring the whole pack of cards tumbling down, they just railroad the individuals who've got the nous to take it to court. So, yeah, the court system is controlled. It's not there for our benefit. People. You know, it's the crown, isn't it? And people don't realise the crown is not part of the UK. It's a separate, separate country.
Yeah. Well, no, you were right first time. It's a separate company.
Company, country, same difference. They're all corporations, aren't they?
Exactly, yeah.
And the Crown Corporation of the City of City of London seems to be behind everything you see going on.
Yeah, again, that is covered in the book. You know, I go into great detail about the City of London and, you know, how everything is what that you believe is a public institution is actually a corporation. So that's all in there too. I'm sure that sort of stuff is familiar to a lot of people, so I won't go into any detail on it. But, you know, it's a fact. It's an inescapable fact. But I don't believe that you'd ever win if you went to court to contest that. Because as we just pointed out, you know, the courts are bent as the people who are committing the scam on us, you know. So.
Something I'd like to ask, John, is did you find any connection in your investigations between the banking industry and Freemasonry?
Well, only in as much as that the Freemasonry is connected to everything of that ilk. Yeah, I mean, nothing that I could specifically hang my hat on and say, yes, that, you know, the obviously the people at the top are all Freemasons, but then you could apply that to any institution. You know, most of them, 99% of them are Freemasons, and not just Freemasons, but 32nd or 33rd degree Freemasons, which, for those who don't know, those are the top 2 degrees. And those are the people who basically run the world.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, I've not found a specific link in terms of, you know, yes, it's specifically the banking people, the banksters, as I call them, that are linked to Freemasonry, because I think the whole shooting matches. I mean, have you got any sort of thoughts on that?
Well, my thoughts particularly are that they may not be an obvious direct connection, but it does seem that whatever we seem to look into, Freemasonry is almost like the glue that binds it all together.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that's right. But as I say, it's not just banking, it's the whole thing. It's
yeah.
The whole shooting match. Yeah.
If you've got, you know, the bankers are obviously in cahoots with the judges, who are in cahoots with the councils, who, I mean, there must be some kind of a common link, because you can't say, well, all the judges and all the councillors and all the bankers all went to the same school together, or they all drink in the same pub. It wouldn't be physically possible. But I'm just wondering, well, I'm not wondering, I'm firmly convinced that is the glue that binds it all together and allows all these disparate elements to work so seamlessly together.
Yeah. Yeah, another book that I'd recommend for anybody who's interested in looking at that Freemasonry connection is The Brotherhood. Who wrote it now? Stephen.
Oh, what was his name? Stephen something.
I can't remember. But Stephen somebody.
I read it many years ago. Yeah, it's an excellent book.
It's worth another read if you get hold of a copy. I've still got my copy. It's very battered and doggy. But, I mean, the poor guy was murdered shortly after that. You know, I don't know whether you're aware of that.
No, I wasn't.
By the usual modus operandi, which is poison.
That's
his favourite assassination method.
It's available on amazon.co.uk for £4.74 Kindle. There's a hardcover version for a penny, but I bet that's got about a tenner postage on it. Or it's on paperback for $9.99 with Prime delivery. So.
And who was it, Stephen?
Stephen Knight. I should have remembered that, because I'd got a friend at the time I read it called Steve Knight.
Yes. Yeah. And, then Stephen Knight was also involved in the... the business Jack the Ripper, the real identity of Jack the Ripper coming to light in the 1970s. He was intrinsically involved in that. Although I don't know quite what his motivation was, but he seemed to think that it wasn't the person that the evidence seemed to point at. But that's another story, probably for another time. But Stephen Knight's book just absolutely lays bare what goes on in Freemasonry, and as I say, it's well worth a read. I'm not on commission for it, by the way.
No, absolutely, we're not either, and I don't particularly like promoting Amazon, but it is a good way of finding books that are sometimes quite hard to get hold of in bookshops. For anyone who is listening but not actually in the chat room, if you go to our website, raconteursnews.com, and go to the live/chat room page, you can actually listen from there. And also, I have posted the link to John's book and to Stephen Knight's book, The Brotherhood, in there.
Yeah, cheers, Andy. Thanks. Yeah.
Oh, Jeff's just corrected me. It's not a tenner postage. It's £2.80 post and packaging for the hardback. So that's not so bad. £2.81 the you can have a hardback book. That's pretty good. Probably second hand and a bit dog-eared, but yeah, well worth having.
Yeah. Best ones. Definitely the best ones. Well, I think it's about an hour now. We've been on. The first hour's gone like mad, hasn't it? It's just flown by.
Yeah, it always does, doesn't it?
So around about this time, we play a tune. Have you got a tune lined up, Andy? We'll play a tune. We'll go and have a bit of a comfort break. Just a reminder, you're listening to Raconteurs News on raconteursnews.com this Thursday night. And it's, it's 1 minute past eight. It's not 1 minute past the top of the hour. It's 1 minute past eight.
Fabulous, Jase.
And we've got Doc Rock coming up at 9 o'clock, and I think we're just going to take a quick record and a bit of a comfort break.
Yeah, what I've lined up, I thought when we were talking about banksters, I couldn't find any particular songs about banksters, but I remembered a video I watched recently online called All Wars Are Bankers' Wars, so let's have one of Keno's more recent hits, War.
Pay for the privilege of being alive. Give your kids to the state. You know it's good for them. Give all your money to the rich. They know what's best for you. Stand by as your community crumbles. Watch TV and eat shit. Catch a terminal disease and die young. And, above all else, don't mention the war!
This is Colin Johnson from East Coast Resistance, and you're listening to Raconteurs News.
And welcome back to Raconteurs News, this wonderful, rainy midsummer's Thursday evening. Me and Jason as usual, and this evening we're joined by John Hamer. Welcome back, John.
Hi, thanks.
And so we kind of covered a basic outline of your book, but perhaps you'd like to give us a little bit more detail, obviously without spoiling it for anyone.
I mean, the problem that I have is there's so much in there, it's difficult to know where to... I mean, there's a lot of generalisation in there, you know, talking about things like the war of terror as opposed to the war on terror. But there's also, you know, a fair few specifics in there, you know, such as the JFK assassination, the moon landings hoax, and the fact that Yuri Gagarin, for example, you know, the alleged first man in space, was part of the deal that was brokered between America and Russia to allow America to claim the first moon landings, combined with the Bay of Pigs as well, so that it wasn't too much of a disparity between claiming credit for the moon landings and claiming credit for the first man in space. The Americans took the Bay of Pigs in there as well, because Kennedy actually negotiated that he would not sanction the Bay of Pigs invasion. So it was just done behind his back anyway.
Wasn't the first man in space Vladimir Ilyushin?
It was meant to be Vladimir Ilyushin, but whether it was actually him or not, I mean, the one that they say it was Yuri Gagarin, wasn't it?
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, well, there's a really good film that I'd recommend anybody watches. It's just, if you look online, it's, I can't remember its name, but it is Vladimir, if you search Vladimir Ilyushin, he was a space pilot, and he was a pioneer of the Ilyushin Airlines, the aeroplanes. And so he allegedly was the first man in space, but the mission went wrong. And he actually landed in China, and at that time, China and Russia were at loggerheads, and they kept Ilyushin in hospital because he was quite injured for a number of months. It's a really good, interesting documentary.
Yeah. Yeah, like I said, a couple of little bits of that, not specifically that, but about Gagarin and how that was a hoax, and as I say, how it was, because a lot of people, what kicked me off on that tack was a lot of people used to say to me when I used to talk about the moon landing hoax, yeah, but the Russians would never have gone along with it. And I used to think, yeah, interesting. Now, why would the Russians go along with it? And the reason that I found that the Russians went along with it was because they'd already been given the minor prize of being allowed to say that they had the first man in space, Yuri Gagarin, who actually never went to space at all. And but as I was saying before, the Americans, or more specifically JFK, said that as part of the deal, he wouldn't sanction the Bay of Pigs invasion. But as I said, that didn't happen anyway. They just went behind his back anyway and went ahead with that. But for some reasons, the Russians still stuck to their part of the bargain, and didn't question the big moon landing hoax, which was obviously out of the three of them, that was the real biggie. So, yeah, it's so easy to prove that Gagarin never went into space. You know, with the interviews that he had afterwards, I've seen one or two with translations, assuming that the translations are genuine. But, you know, he made all sorts of errors. You know, he said he was wearing the wrong kind of colour clothing. He said that there were no, he said he saw South America out of the portholes in this spaceship, and apparently his ship didn't have any portholes. They asked him if he'd got, you know, how many good pictures it'd taken, and he said, well, it didn't even have a camera. And he just looked completely dumbfounded at this interview, as if you picked somebody off the street and said, right, there's going to be a load of guys asking you some questions, you know, about, you know, we've told them that you're the first man into space, right? So go in that room and just answer a few questions. Just make it up as you go along, basically. We don't give a stuff. And it's just as though that had happened because he's just clueless. And it's so obvious that, you know, what he's saying is untrue. And there's a lot more to it than that, but that's just a brief synopsis of it, yeah.
Yeah, and also with the what seems to be obvious collaboration between America and Russia over the lies that were told to us about their various space programs.
Yeah.
That's got to bring you towards the Cold War, which, as far as I've been able to ascertain, was completely bogus as well.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, it was just, I mean, it was like what we have now, the war on terror. Seems to have got a little bit of feedback. I don't know how that's coming through, but are you okay? Can you hear me okay?
Okay now.
Yeah. Sorry, I've lost my thread now. What was I saying? Yeah, the Cold War was just basically the war on terror of the 1950s, 60s, 70s and 80s, basically. It was just their way of keeping everybody in fear and trepidation, and obviously a few fearful people are more easily controlled. So when the Cold War ended in the early 1990s and the Berlin Wall came down and all that, they had to come up with something new to keep us all in fear and trepidation. And obviously the war on terror was, and you know, all these evil Muslim terrorists was the answer.
Mm-hmm. Well, I remember back from my school days in the 60s and 70s, the way the Cold War was put towards you, we were quite convinced a lot of the time that any minute now,
yeah,
there'd be an atom,
yeah,
drop and we'd all have to hide under our desks. Which,
that's right. Yeah, that would have saved your life, wouldn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, duck and cover, yeah. I mean, and then when it seemed that was wearing a bit thin, suddenly AIDS came along and put the fear of God into anybody who was spreading their love a bit too generously.
Absolutely, yeah.
But I believe you've got a chapter in your book called The War of Terror.
The War of Terror, yeah. Mm-hmm. Basically, what's that? I'm getting the feedback again, guys. Does it sound bad at your end? It's like I've got an echo in all the time I'm talking. Now it's gone again now. Okay. Sorry about that. Yeah, the war of terror. Let's come back. The war of terror. Sorry about this.
Yeah, sorry, John. It's just Skype. It does that from time to time.
Yeah,
it's been behaving itself.
Is it coming
itself through
your end?
No, it's sounding pretty good. There's a slight echo, but it's...
I'll try and ignore it then.
If you could.
Yeah, I've got a chapter called The War of Terror, which is obviously a play on words of the war on terror. And basically what I'm saying is exactly what we just alluded to, and the fact that the war on terror was created artificially as the next fear and trepidation chapter in our lives, if you like. So basically what they're doing, they're scaring us to death with the threat of terrorism. You know, that every time we go on a plane, we might be bombed out of the sky. You know, if we go into a shopping mall, there's a danger of, you know, explosions. So, you know, really just expanding on that theme an awful lot. It's just complete nonsense. You know, the facts and figures that you get about terrorism, you know, it's something like 6 people been killed in the United States in the last 5 years in terrorist attacks. 6 people in you know, and even that's debatable, I guess, you know, because what they call terrorist attacks and what are really terrorist attacks are probably completely different. You know, compare that to the 750,000 that die every year as a result of hospital or doctor errors. You know, where's the war on hospital errors? You know, 750,000 people a year as opposed to 6 people in 5 years. And yet the anti-terrorism budget is about 50 times greater than the medical budget, you know. So I just really go into detail about that. It's all nonsense, and it's all just there to make us basically live in fear because it's easier to control people.
Yeah, fear is a great control weapon. I mean, you see it being used all over the place, but if we're not in fear of these psychopaths, they really lost the control over us. So what I'd urge everyone to do is get informed, lose the fear, and you know, challenge it head on.
Yeah. And what I also sort of make allusions to, again, another book that I would recommend people read, and I'm going to promise you I'm not on commission, is 1984 by George Orwell. You know, it's a very popular book, very common book, but a lot of people have not read it, and people should read it because it's an absolute blueprint for what is happening today. It's exactly what is happening today. Yeah. Coincidence? I don't believe in coincidences, you know, but that's just the way it is. It's absolutely staggering. I read it about 20 years ago. I read it at school originally, then I read it about 20 years ago, and then I read it again last year, and it was just incredible, the similarities between what's going on in the world today and what happens in 1984.
Yeah, so I can hear you're getting a bit of an echo there, John, but Tony's just posted in the chat room that the echo's not coming through on air, so we're doing quite... I mean, 1984, I'd absolutely agree with you there. I mean... It was probably one of the most important books I ever read, if not the most important. I read it about the age of 12 or 13, and then I read it again when I was 16 at the encouragement of my English teacher at school. And it was probably the only worthwhile book I ever actually read while I was at school. There was a lot of Shakespeare and all that stuff. Yeah. Yes, there is some interesting stuff in Shakespeare, but when you start pulling it apart, it's another way of steering people, isn't it?
Yes.
You know, and then you start looking into who was William Shakespeare. Was it actually somebody else, or was it a group of people, or you know?
Yeah. Well, I'd say one of my contacts, I would say, is the greatest world authority on who wrote Shakespeare. He is more or less devoted his whole life to looking into that situation, and I couldn't begin to explain it the way that he does, but it's absolutely fascinating. And you should have him on, actually, because he's a Canadian guy called Tim Watson. His pen name is Tim Spearman, Shakespeare Spearman. But I'll tell you, he's fascinating, and to listen to how he has come to the conclusions he has about who wrote Shakespeare and what it was really all about and what it relates to. It's brilliant. Absolutely amazing.
That's a great idea, John. That would give me the opportunity to try and look intelligent and quote Shakespeare, because I can actually remember a few of the speeches. Because I was one of those people at school. I was very lucky in that I had a very retentive memory, so I could learn speeches and poetry and all that stuff, and I could get the gist of a book by flicking through it. So I managed to pass all my O-levels by just remembering stuff. I mean, most of my O-levels, 60% of the marks were on, what was it, Julius Caesar, the book. And I was a borderline F grade when we went into the exam, because 40% was on coursework. And it was 60% coursework, borderline fail. And I did the exam having never read the book and came out with a grade B. So must have done fairly well on that.
Yeah.
Well, so we all love a bit of Shakespeare, don't we, though? A nice Shakespeare quote, you know, like, I have a dream.
Yes, yeah. It's actually amazing how many Shakespeare quotes we use in real life without actually realizing that they're from Shakespeare. It's just literally hundreds. The English language is just full of them. Whether that's by design or by the, you know, sheer brilliance of the English. Because, I mean, whoever wrote the damn thing, you've got to admit that, you know, it's beautiful. The language is absolutely stunning, even though you don't necessarily understand a lot of it at face value, because it's different. It's not what we're used to. But when you see it in the context of the play, when you actually go and sit in the theatre and watch the play, it all becomes sort of, it all fits in, you understand it, and it's just so, it's stunning, really. So whoever wrote it, I mean, it's just an amazing body of work.
Speaking of which, speaking of writing, you know, when you were when you began writing this book, did you have a single firm vision of what you wanted to write, or did you sort of like have an idea of what you wanted to write, and then you started going down sort of all different tangents, and hence it's ended up being part one, and it's 1,100 pages.
Yeah, I wrote the latter really. I mean, I just started writing. I know people sometimes think I'm crazy when I say stuff like this. Maybe I am, but when I'm writing, it's almost like I've completely, my brain is switched off, and I just go into sort of automatic mode. It's like I'm, you know, you hear all this stuff about automatic writing and that. Yeah, I wouldn't go that far. It's not like I believe that somebody up there is writing it through me or anything like that. But sometimes I write a piece, you know, just a paragraph. I think, where the hell did that come from? I know, I can barely believe that I wrote it. I know it's a really weird thing, and it probably sounds crazy, but I just tend to write, and it flows out my fingers. And then when I've written it, I start to think, right, well, where will that bit go? How does that fit into the big jigsaw? Think of it like as a jigsaw puzzle, I do, and I try and sort of put each little piece in place. And then that, you know, when I've written that bit, I think, ah, yeah, well, that's connected to that. So that goes there, and I'll write that bit there as well, because that is intrinsically connected to that. And it gets extremely complex after a while, but, and again, when I actually come to editing the book and sorting it out into some semblance of proper order, you know, that seems to come naturally as well through some strange, I don't know. Again, I don't want to come across like a loony or something, but it's almost as I'm being guided by some sort of outside force. I can't put it any more, plainly than that, really.
And the sad thing is that you felt a little bit reticent about saying something like that, when that's perfectly, to people like myself and Andy, that's perfectly acceptable and perfectly, perfectly reasonable answer.
Absolutely. I know what you're saying, yeah. Well, yeah, it is, because, we're conditioned just to think that's crazy. That could never happen in real life. That's just weirdos that believe things like that. Yeah, absolutely. I know, and sort of regret saying it now, but I know what you mean.
No, absolutely not, John. I mean, crazy is the new normal in my life anyway. I've spoke to, through the process of doing this show and the other ones that I've done, and just talking up with people, I've spoke to writers, musicians and artists, and an awful lot of them seem to say, well, it didn't come from me, it came through me. I just wrote it down, or I just, you know, the tune flowed out of my fingertips, or, you know, I just got some paint and that's what happened.
Exactly. You know, I talk about sportsmen being in the zone. Well, it's like the sort of literary equivalent of being in the zone. You know, and yet some days it doesn't happen at all. I've sat at my laptop many a day and thought, right, well, I'll finish that bit now. And I just sit there and I type a few words and think, no, that's not right, that's no good. And I'll delete it all and start again. No. And then I'll sod it, I'll go on my lunch. I'm not on it today at all. You know, so it is very much like that.
We've got Tony, who does great work for us at RNE. He sorted our website out for us. He's working together with Jimmy and Nick on the new solution for broadcasting. He says, same here, he's not in control. So does that mean you're out of control, Tony? I don't know.
Good old Tony. We love Tony. He's not in control now. If there's somebody else in control of him, then we love them too.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, it is interesting. Even the titles of my books, I don't know where they came from either. You know, I sort of know where Behind the Curtain came from, because that was a quote from the Jerome Daly case that you were talking about while I was briefly otherwise engaged. The judge said when another case came to court, similar to Daly's, where he was trying to get his mortgage annulled for the same reasons as Daly, the judge actually said, we can't do that. We're not going there. We're not going behind that curtain. And so that's where I got it from, behind the curtain. But again, it sort of popped into my brain, and I thought, yeah, that's perfect. You know, that's a perfect title for the book.
That is a curious phrase, because when you look at the Wizard of Oz, it seems that was written to tell us all about the banking industry. But I'm sure one of the people that, if not more, that have come on to the show talking about their challenges to the legal system have actually said they've had the same phrase from a judge: we're not going behind that curtain.
Really? Yeah.
So I don't know if that's some kind of secret Masonic language or...
It could be. It wouldn't surprise me, mate, to be honest. So perhaps that'll ring a lot of bells with a lot of people up there.
I know you've just finished this book and it took you quite a while. Are you taking a rest now, or are you straight into something else, John?
I'm just having a brief sabbatical through the summer, and then I'm going to start when the dark nights start closing in about July. No, in about, you know, the end of September, early October. I'm going to start on something else. I've already got it sort of outlined in my head what I'm going to do. And again, you know, it's just sort of slowly taking shape. I think about it from time to time as I'm going along. And I thought, what about doing a companion volume to The Falsification of History and calling it The Falsification of Science? Because those two things seem to me the main, you know, way that we're controlled, you know, through lying about history and through lying about science. And I thought, that's perfect. It's, you know, there's perfect synergy there between those two things.
That sounds brilliant. I'm really looking forward to hearing about that book, John, because, you know, I was quite scientifically minded. I was kind of really wrapped up in science when I was younger.
Mm.
A lot of it, physics, a little bit of chemistry, not so big on the biology. But as I've got older and I've started digging deeper, I just find out that so much of what we're taught just doesn't make any sense. Mm. You know, and you can pull holes in it. I mean, a classic example, we were talking to an engineer who's found a marvelous solution to help people feel better, to be healthier, to remedy all sorts of maladies with the body. Mm. And it was all about he picked up a biology textbook that was talking about how trees get water from their roots up to their leaves. And there were various different explanations in there. He debunked all of them, and he's worked on it until he's found out how it actually works. And then he's applied that new science to the human body. And, you know, people are saying, well, what shall I prop your head up on? And I love his answer: medical books, because they all need to be rewritten now. They're all leather rubbish.
Sure, absolutely.
Yeah, this...
Well, again, it's down to...
Sorry, I was just going to say, when you're talking about your new book, The Falsification of Science, I don't know if you've seen it, but there's a very, very interesting talk by a guy called Rupert Sheldrake. I don't know if you've ever heard of him.
I have indeed, yeah.
Yep, and he does it. It's, I think it's on, if you go on YouTube and you go on Banned TED Talks, and he talks about science and the way that it's become dogmatic, and how he got a huge hole in it when he discovered that the speed of light had changed over a number of years. Now, I've got my own theories on why that happened, but that's sort of an example of how science is dogmatic, and yet you can cut holes in it, and then it sort of gets banned. I'm sure you've come across Rupert Sheldrake's talk.
I don't think I've seen that specific one, but I do know Rupert Sheldrake, yeah. Absolutely. But I mean, there's so many things that I've already sort of, I've started, you know, as I do, I've started jotting down stuff And I'll just briefly go through one or two things. And if you want to talk about any of those, I'm quite happy to do that. Mm-hmm. I mean, my number one controlling theory, because if you notice in science, there's a lot of theories, but these theories are all always regarded as absolute unquestionable facts. Mm-hmm. You know, the theory of evolution. Bollocks. It's absolute garbage. You only need to scratch the surface of that to see that evolution is just utter, utter nonsense. And the reason that they brought evolution in was because they wanted to discredit religion, because, you know, the world was becoming a more technological place, and they wanted to replace the old-fashioned science of religion with this new science of man being created by, you know, coming from, single-celled animals, basically, over a period of time. But again, that is the even more deeper aspect to that is the fact that they wanted people to think that life is nothing. You know, life is nothing special. Life is just, you know, you're born and you die and that's your lot, mate. One way of doing that was to invent evolution and discredit religion. Now, I don't believe in organized religion, don't get me wrong, but I'm certainly a spiritual person, and I believe that there is a spiritual purpose to our lives. But again, I don't want to go into that at this point because I think that's going into too much detail. But evolution, the theory of evolution, the Big Bang theory, again, you know, there are certain scientists who are non-mainstream who just absolutely poo-poo the Big Bang theory. They just say that's been derived, again, for a similar sort of reason. It's to keep us in control. And again, without going into too much detail about that, because, you know, I don't want to get wrapped up in that. But, and then there's like the other mainstream theory that dinosaurs were wiped out by a meteorite hitting the Earth. Now, if you ask people, those went out on the streets, I guarantee you, in the Western world anyway, and ask people, you know, what, how did the Earth come about? How did life begin? And they all say, oh, well, it was a big bang and blah, blah, blah. The planets formed and, they started circling around the sun and the sun's cooled and the planets cooled. And then evolution took place and X number of million years later, here we are. Absolute garbage. If you asked anybody how the dinosaurs died out, that say, oh, well, a meteorite hit the Earth apparently about 65 million years ago, and all the dust was thrown up into the atmosphere, and there was a nuclear winter for about 1,000 years, and of course the dinosaurs didn't survive. Garbage. If the dinosaurs didn't survive, why did the mammals survive? You know, it's all, you know, sops for the masses, basically. I mean, I don't even believe that dinosaurs ever existed. I know that might sound really freaky and controversial, but I really don't. I really just think it's part of that same old, all this, you know, basically just controlling, and dinosaurs were there to show us that the Earth is a lot older than we originally believed it was, because there's so much evidence to say. I'm a big fan of a guy called Michael Crichton. I don't know if anybody's ever heard of Michael Crichton, but Michael Crichton was the guy who wrote Jurassic Park.
Yeah.
Well, I believe that Michael Crichton was part of the master plan, if you like, to foist that idea of dinosaurs upon us. And I think that's why Jurassic Park was promoted so heavily, because if you know the films, it within that evolution is covered massively, and it's really promoted the fact that there are lots of different kinds of dinosaurs and the DNA still exists and we can recreate them if the technology ever comes around. I just feel that, it's all too tenuous, and anybody who looks, just scrapes beneath the surface even a tiny little bit, I'm sure they'll agree with what I'm saying.
Mm. Have you come across Peter Plichter, John?
Who, sorry?
Peter Plichter.
I can't hear the last name, mate. Sorry.
Plichter. P-L-I-C-H-T-A.
No, I haven't.
Right. Well, I was recommended to read one of his books a while back by a very good friend. And
right,
it's called God's Secret Formula. And it's quite a short book, only about 160 pages. But in it, it explains how Plictor, instead of specialising in one science, he learned all the different sciences. And there were so many things that didn't ring true. He set about proving that it was complete bunkum. And he went to this particularly high up physicist and explained to him what he discovered. And the guy says, well, you've absolutely proved that modern physics is a complete pile of tosh.
Yeah.
But we can't go along with it.
Yeah, absolutely.
And now, I mean, I've read that book and it had some real light bulb moments for me, particularly when you find out that the universe has got certain numbers that are consistent throughout everything. And also then you start looking at the prime number cross. You know, you start arranging numbers in a certain way, you get this prime number cross, and all the prime numbers lie within this particular cross. And lo and behold, that cross, it's on the top of the English crown. It's the Maltese cross. It's it's used everywhere.
Right.
Why is that particular symbol so prevalent in these occult
answers on a postcard too? Yeah.
So who is that? Peter Sphincter.
Very nearly. Peter Plictor.
Right, okay.
He's a German, so I'm sure it's Peter Plictor, but yeah. Because Ken does correct me every time I say his name that I've got it wrong.
Well, point me to that. Point me to that on Amazon, actually. I'm quite interested in that. But, you know, going back to the falsification of science, I mean, I think that what happens is that the powers that be, the banksters, if you like, they present us with these fakes, these frauds, people like Einstein, people like, you know, in more modern times, people like Stephen Hawking. To me, I don't think he bloody exists, that guy. I think that is just, I mean, he's the only man who has ever managed to live 50 years with whatever disease, motor neuron disease, is it? He's the only man that's ever managed to live so long with that disease. I cannot believe that he is genuine at all. Now, anybody else would have been dead 50 years ago. The survival rate is zero, basically. But he's lived into his 70s, apparently. Anyway, so there's him. And then you get these even more modern ones. I'm thinking of the guy now. I can see his face, but I can't remember his name. Is the BBC put him on in a lot of physics programs. He's like the popular...
Brian Cox.
That's him. What a git he is. I mean, please. You know, absolute... You know...
Dickhead.
Yeah, a dickhead, basically. Where they got him from, I have no idea. So that guy is a professor. He should be bloody well ashamed of himself, actually.
Well, he's a keyboard player.
Sold his soul to the devil, yes.
He was a keyboard player with D. Ream, wasn't he? Single-handedly responsible for Tony Blair getting elected. So, you know, that says it all for me.
Well, absolutely, yeah. Yeah. So, yeah, you know, I don't want to single him out. I don't want to be unfair and single him out because, I mean, there's hundreds of the buggers, but,
let's be unfair. He's a wanker. That's all he is. He's just a complete wanker.
Yeah, I mean, come off the fence.
There's loads of them about. They're just everywhere. Eamon Holmes, just a complete wanker.
Yeah, but at least he doesn't pretend to be clever, you know. He's just... I know what you're saying, though, yeah. I mean, there's other these pseudo-scientists that they put on. There's a woman, she used to do it, like, with a Bristol accent. She used to... Alice somebody, she used to do a lot of so-called biological programs, which just seemed to me to be a front for promoting evolution as being the absolute holy truth, you know. Can't remember her surname.
Is that Alice Roberts?
Yes, that's her, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, the BBC are just full of people like that. And it's like they wheel them out. There you go, you wind them up, off they go. You know, and they spew out all this rubbish and garbage. And all it is, it's just absolute propaganda to propagandise people into believing whatever crap they want us to believe at the time.
Well, it's the same thing with evolution. I mean, what they do is we've got this evolution where we evolve from monkeys, and then you think to yourself, well, why are there still monkeys then if we evolved from them? Right? Why are there still monkeys? Right? Mm. And then, but the instigating that, what they call the missing link, so there's a bit of a mystery. Yeah. So people are then looking for that and not realizing and thinking, hang on a minute, you know, we've evolved from monkeys. Why is there still monkeys?
Exactly. Well, one of the biggest killers for me with evolution is the fact is dinosaur bones, right?
Mm-hmm.
The only actual dinosaur bones in existence are all behind locked doors, allegedly, in some of the big scientific institutes of the world, like the Smithsonian and British Museum and places like that. There are none on display. All the ones that you see when you go into that British Museum and you see a dinosaur skeleton, it's a fake. You know, it's not a real skeleton because there aren't any.
Mm.
But they say, oh, no, well, we don't put the real ones out because, you know, it's, you know, they're too valuable and, you know, we can't possibly risk them being damaged or broken or destroyed. So, don't worry, though. We've got all the real ones under lock and key, you know. And nobody had ever found any dinosaur skeletons until, funnily enough, the same decade as evolution was propounded, the 1850s, there were no dinosaur skeletons or bones even found anywhere in the world. And the only ones that get found now are always by establishment scientists. No, you know, no guy with a metal detector, not that they're metal, but that kind of guy who goes, you know, amateur sort of fossil collector, never ever finds anything to do with a dinosaur because they just don't bloody well exist, basically. Mm. And I don't, and you know, I absolutely believe that dinosaurs never existed. It's just another facet of them trying to prove to us that evolution is you know, is the holy truth.
Mm. So, yes, I mean, I have seen that put forward that the dinosaurs never existed, all the fossils are fake. Where do you stand on the? There seems to be numerous reports of giant human skeletons being found, you know, 10, 15, 20 feet tall. And those bones seem to all be taken to the Smithsonian and they never see the light of day again. But
absolutely. It's too valuable for us plebs to see them. You know, they don't want them broken or lost or damaged, you know. So they've got to put them behind lock and key, Andy. You know, I mean, be fair. Come on.
Mm.
No, I'm being facetious. No, I just think it's part of the same thing there.
Uh-huh.
They don't want us to know stuff like that because it contradicts their version of the truth. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know whether those skeletons are real or not, to be frank. I haven't got a clue, but it wouldn't surprise me if they were real. There is some sort of, you know, different answer to how we as a race were created. I was going to use the word evolved then, but I don't think it did evolve at all. I'm a creationist, basically.
What do you think these mammal bipeds that are inhabiting this planet that we're on for thousands and thousands and thousands of years? What do you think happened to spark the progress we've had in technology in the last 200 years?
In the last 200 years?
Well, yeah, I mean, we've had a huge technology rush that's gone on from 200 years ago to now. I mean, the technology's exponentially exploded. I mean,
it has.
Was any particular thing that happened at any point in time?
Yeah, well, I honestly don't know the answer to that now. I really don't. But I know that that has happened on several separate occasions going back through time. There's been, you know, the first major one was 5,000 years ago when all of a sudden what we're told were these creatures that had evolved from chimpanzees or apes of some sort. Suddenly, a civilization sprang up from nothing 5,000 years ago in Babylon. But even more than that, quite separately and quite distant from each other, other civilizations sprang up in the Indus Valley, which is in, you know, the near the middle to far east on the edge of what is now India, and also the Aztec Inca civilizations. and the Egyptian civilizations also sprung up more or less at the same time, quite independently of each other. Now, you know, this is a heavenly-based answer. This can't answer your 200-year one. There has been other instances of things like that happening quite spontaneously, they say. But, yeah, I'm not clever enough to answer that, I'm afraid. Or I don't have the knowledge to answer that. It's more to the point.
But also, when we're talking about the falsification of science and history, which I think the two are linked when you look at Egypt,
absolutely.
Because you get John Anthony West and Robert Schock seem to prove pretty conclusively that the Sphinx is 25,000 years old plus.
Yeah.
You know, we're told by people like Zahi Hawass, who seems to be just a gatekeeper. He's just after protecting his own job and the industry of Egyptology. We're told that no civilization as such existed. We were all hunter-gatherers up until 5,000 years ago. And that kind of conflicts with what happens when you look at Göbekli Tepe, which was deliberately buried about 12,000 years ago. So a hunter-gatherer society could not have possibly built something so technologically advanced and complex as Göbekli Tepe.
Yeah, I mean, it's all fascinating stuff. And, you know, I'd certainly be interested to look into it a lot more than I already have. But, you know, I don't have the answers to that, really.
No, well, I've got on my reading list, I've got, I believe it's Andrew Collins wrote the book on Göbekli Tepe, because when my good lady was looking for Graham Hancock's Fingerprints of the Gods, Magicians of the Gods, the latest version, that book came up and she thought, oh, I'll get him that one as well. So, I'm looking forward to reading a bit more about Göbekli Tepe because it really has caught my imagination. I suppose not least because Turkey's one of my favourite places to visit. I find it's got an astounding history, absolutely fascinating place and such warm people to meet. The kind of conflicts with the story we're getting in the press about Turkey, but for me, it's a marvellous place.
Yeah, well, that can't be a bad thing, conflicting with the mainstream press, can it, really?
No.
Yeah, I mean, if anybody's interested in looking into, you know, the truth about evolution, creation, whatever, there's another book I'd recommend. I'm sorry to keep doing this, but it's by a guy called James Perloff, who's an American guy, and it's called Tornado in a Junkyard. And basically the title of the book is about, you know, the actual creation of the human body is about as likely through evolution as it would be as a tornado going through a junkyard and constructing a Boeing 747 out of it.
Absolutely. That ties in with a video that was recommended to me recently. I think it was by Tony. And that's called, it's by a guy called Michael Behe, B-E-H-E. And I'm sure the title of the lecture is called Irreducible Complexity.
Yes.
And it shows you some tiny, tiny organisms that couldn't possibly have come into existence by evolution. They must have appeared at some point fully formed, because each part of it cannot function without the other part.
Well, that's one of the creationists' arguments, isn't it? That irreducible complexity. They use the eye as an example, and I think it's a particularly good example, whether it be a human eye or the eye of any living creature. It's impossible that all the component parts of an eye could have evolved into what it is now, because, and it's quite simple proof against evolution, because it can't sort of partially evolve into, you know, a partially working organ. I mean, how does it suddenly become an eye, you know, with all the complex, you know, workings and machinations about how an eye actually works, all the different, you know, parts of it. It just couldn't suddenly appear, And how does it evolve? Because the only way that you can, because the evolutionists claim that, you know, it's by natural selection. So an animal would suddenly acquire one mutation that is beneficial to it, and so that will remain in its gene pool, and it will reproduce. So if it can't suddenly just acquire an eye, and then from there on that animal has an eye, and that's true of lots and lots of different organs. And that's the irreducible complexity argument against evolution, because you can't have a part of an eye. You know, you can't just suddenly say, I'm struggling here to get my point across, but I hope I'm being understood, you know.
Absolutely, yeah. But eyes made up of so many components. The lens, there's the pupil. Pupil is the lens. The iris, there's the rods, the cones.
Yeah.
You can't just sort of have a, well, it's nearly an eye, can you?
No, absolutely.
Yeah.
And Tony said, it was him, obviously. He said that if anyone wants the video, he's happy to send it to him. So if you go in the chat room and send a private message to Tony Hurst, he'll send you a link to that or send you the video, because it's not available on SpewTube, apparently.
Nice one.
Yeah, so I mean, that was just, I know we digressed a little bit or to falsification of science, but there's all sorts of other things. I'd kind of just touch briefly on them if I may. You know, all these fake scientists, like I've sort of given a few examples, but there's hundreds of them. The people have sold their souls to the devil. They don't really believe what they're promoting. I'm absolutely convinced of that. You know, it's part of the celebrity cult almost, you know.
Mm.
And then there's things like global warming. I mean, everybody knows. Everybody with, you know, a quarter of a brain knows that global warming is just a complete scam. I mean, the science behind that is just absolutely ludicrous.
Yeah, but if you pay more tax, it'll solve it.
Of course, yeah.
Do you think as well, in the alternative media, we're starting to mirror that in the mainstream, starting to have these people that are... you know, the go-to people for certain issues, whereas perhaps we should be diversifying a little bit further. Speaking to more people, more obscure, different people.
Yeah, sorry, I don't really understand the point you're making then, Jason.
What I'm saying is, as you said, in the mainstream media, they've got these talking heads that they refer to, you know, Brian Cox, all these things. Now, what I'm saying is that, don't you think that we're starting to mimic that in the alternative media and alternative thinking websites and you know, shows and different things, that we're starting to mimic that? We've got a go-to person and they're the number one. So we're going for a name rather than the information itself.
Yeah, possibly. Yeah, what you think of people like David Icke or, you know, that kind of thing?
I'm not particularly specifically David Icke, but, you know, David Icke, Alex Jones, all the regular people, you know, that sort of seem to pop up everywhere, and when their influence and when the size and their influence changes, and so does the narrative. It seems to change as well. I mean, I've noticed that with InfoWars recently, that narrative seems to have changed quite a lot, and they've got really, really big.
Mm. Yeah, absolutely. But have they got really, really big because they've somehow been infiltrated and taken over?
Mm. You've always got to ask that question. And Jason, this has kind of worked like magic. What you've just been talking about there has led perfectly into Doc Rock's show that's coming up in just under 5 minutes now, because tonight the Doc Rock's radio show is all about the Dark Mountain Project, and he's going to be joined by Nick Hunt and Steve Wheeler to discuss the Dark Mountain Project at darkmountain.net. And apparently a network of writers, artists and thinkers who have stopped believing the story of our civilization is telling itself. In a world that is founded on stories of all kinds, the network encourages investigation of modern myths that define our ideas of civilization and consideration of the imminent consequences of our beliefs. So,
that's exactly what we've been talking about, isn't it?
Exactly. So we've just been here for 2 hours, giving a good old build up for the doc, even though we didn't realise we were doing it. But you know, it's always a worthwhile cause. I'd like to say we're getting right to the end of the show now, John. Have you got any links to give out where people can contact you or find any more information, or is it just the Amazon?
Yeah, well, I've actually got a Twitter account now. I'm not really a big social media fan, but I've just basically done it to get the word out. So I'm at John Hamer Author, my Twitter. And also the actual link to my author page on Amazon, that terrible organization, it is not a short URL. So all I would say is go to Amazon.co.uk, Amazon.com, and just type my name in, John Hamer, and it'll bring up my page with all my books on.
Yeah, I did a search earlier on, and it came up pretty much right at the very top.
Yes.
That's fabulous. Well, I'd like to say a big thank you for joining us again, John. And I'm looking forward to coming up to your part of the world in September. And hopefully we'll meet you for a pint. And
absolutely. Drag Jason.